star that shines in the night, leading us on till the morning is bright. When God is a child, there's joy in our song. The last shall be first, and the weak shall
for the gift that God will reveal.
We open our hearts as we open the gift.
The promise of hope is a divine gift we receive.
And what will we do with it?
The gift of hope is an essential survival tool because it reminds us that hard times do not have the last word. Hope is not simply a wish. Hope calls us into action based on a belief that things can be different. We can work to bring about the better world that we hope for.
We light this candle of hope as a sign that we will be present with hope in the world.
So they can be a present of hope to others.
May it be so. Amen.
Now we'll sing the refrain to angels we have heard on high. Let us sing together Gloria. Ready? And
top there. Not everyone can have chocolate cake every day, okay?
maybe Betty Alma, but not the rest of us. And things don't always go according to plan, Mr. Hope. That's because we know that things can sometimes be difficult. Earlier, we were sharing all of our prayer concerns, and we realized that there are a lot of people who need help this time of year and always. And so we're wondering how hope can be present to us, the kind of hope that God gives us, and the kind of hope that we give other people. Hope is the story of Jesus' birth and life, and that should give us hope.
Yeah, you know, that's exactly what I meant to say.
Oh, okay. That summed it up. All right. Well, thank you, Hope. We appreciate you coming and being present to us today. So those are all great suggestions. So as we worship today, we're going to think about how we can be a gift of hope. Olivia, there's a little box under the tree, and I wonder if you can bring it down and open it for us. What is in this gift? The lid opens right off if you want to set it down. There you go. Ooh. All right. These are gift tags, and these are ways that you can be a gift of hope, and they even offer suggestions for things you can say to your friends. So what you can do as we worship is you can color these and take them with you and cut them out and share them as messages to your friends. It says things like, and this can be for all of us, I hope you're having a great day. I hope you'll enjoy this snack. I hope we can spend some good time together. And I hope we'll be friends for a long time. Thank you, Hope, for joining us. And I hope you'll be able to get out of this box without breaking it, because we're going to have the present of peace with us next time. You're done. All right. And now we turn our attention to prayer and all the ways that God is calling us to be in ministry with people who are in need. So let us take a few moments to quiet ourselves in an attitude of prayer. I'll pray on the church's behalf, offering many opportunities of silence within our prayers so that we can contemplate what we're praying about. And then we'll close by reciting the Lord's Prayer together. Let us pray. Most holy and gracious God, you are with us always, and we thank you for bringing us the light of Christ into a world where people were walking in darkness. You bid us to remain awake and alert to what you are up to in our lives and in our world. So God, as we pray today, help alert us to your presence, that you are still among us. Gracious God, help us during this most holy season to be present, to be aware of your presence in our lives, to experience times of deep and special connection, to take time to recall why this time of year is truly special, and help us enter into it with anticipation and excitedness. Help us recall special memories of this time, and may it warm our hearts and remind us of why it's important that we welcome you into the world once again. God, help us offer ourselves to others. Before we worshiped, we mentioned many names, and you know each and every situation, those which have been spoken, those printed on our prayer list, and those that reside in our hearts. So help us extend our attentiveness to others. Help us be available to those beyond just ourselves. And help us make differences in other people's lives as we make ourselves present to you. Lord, there are times when we fail to follow your way. And that is, in fact, why you sent your Son into the world in the first place, to bring us back to your heart so that we could truly worship you, serve you, and be in right relationship with you. So right now, let each heart feel the grace and forgiveness we need to be assured that your love never fails, even when we fall short of what you would have us do and be. Help us, O God, work together as a church to strengthen one another in the bounds of fellowship, to be a loving community for those outside our doors, to be hospitable to all people, but especially be open to those who need to know the love and grace, the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We ask, O God, that you help us. Help us savor the journey as well as the celebrations of this time of year. Help us recognize and create moments of sweet and abiding presence. And help us not be tempted to fill the voids with things that do not last and do not truly satisfy. Help us to stop and notice what we are experiencing, accept it with open hearts and minds. In doing this, we allow you to meet us right here, right now, right where we are. We pray this in the name of your Son, who taught his disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Scripture this morning is from Psalms 80, verses 1 through 7 and 17 through 19. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who are enthroned upon Seraphim, shine forth before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh. Stir up your might and come to save us. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine, that we may be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry with your people's prayers? You have fed them with the bread of tears and given them tears to drink in full measure. You make us to scorn of our neighbors, our enemies, laugh among themselves. Restore us, O God of hosts, let your face shine, that we may be saved. But let your hand be upon the one, your right hand, the one whom you made strong for yourself. Then we will never turn back from you. Give us life, and we will call on your name. Restore us, O Lord, God of hosts. Let your face shine, that we may be saved. The word of the Lord for the people.
Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God.
The first gospel reading in Advent comes from the book of Mark. And it describes a time of life as calamity. In the midst of it, Jesus reminds his disciples to make sure they pay attention and don't get distracted by the bad news. Stay awake, stay alert. Hear now a reading from Mark chapter 13. But in those days, after that time of distress, the sun will be darkened, the moon will lose its brightness, the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the promised one coming in the clouds with great power and glory. Then the angels will be sent to gather the chosen from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. Take the fig tree as a parable. As soon as its twigs grow supple and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. In the same way, when you see these things happening, know that the promised one is near, right at the door. The truth is, before this generation will pass away, all these things will have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass. But as for that day or hour, nobody knows it, neither the angels of heaven nor the only begotten, no one but Abba, God. Be constantly on watch. Stay awake. You do not know when the appointed time will come. It is like people traveling abroad. They leave their home and put workers in charge, each one with a certain task. And those who watch at the gate are ordered to stay on the alert. So stay alert. You do not know when the owner of the house is coming, whether at dusk, at midnight, when the cock crows, or at early dawn. Do not let the owner come suddenly and catch you asleep. What I say to you, I say to all. Stay alert. A word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So here we are, the first Sunday of the new liturgical year. Happy New Year! Thank you. I felt it was really glorious to be given an extra Sunday between Thanksgiving and the first Sunday of Advent. I don't know about you, but I felt it was nice to just kind of put a period there at the end of Thanksgiving to give us one more weekend between that and starting this new year. And now Advent is in the month of December rather than starting in November, and it just feels a little more proper and right. Kind of lines up more with the ways that we as a culture get ready for Christmas. And so now here we are. We're already listening to Christmas music. We got to watch the lighting of the Christmas tree at Rockefeller Center this week. We have begun our shopping, and maybe you've made some travel plans. And so it feels like we can begin these things without rushing the season so much. I mean, it's December after all, so Christmas is just right around the corner. For my family, Christmas begins when we see the UK Christmas Collage Holiday Spectacular, which we did yesterday, to a big sold-out crowd. There are over 400 musicians in the Singletary Center performing all kinds of Christmas classics and songs from around the world that I've never heard before, as well as new arrangements. The other tradition we have that perhaps some of you can relate to, we all have our favorite Christmas movies, and we negotiate when we're going to watch which ones so that we can be present together. And so we might gather a couple times during the weeks leading up to Christmas to watch a classic Christmas movie. In fact, Diana, last night was White Christmas. That's why you got a chuckle out of us. But sometimes we try new ones that are out, and those are fun too. The only problem with this is, at the end of the day, when we turn out the lights and just have the glow of the Christmas tree, and we get our comfy little PJs, and we snuggle on the sofa, or Stephen in his recliner, we might get under a blanket and a dog or two, and we finally press play. And I think, wow, I feel so comfortable. I can just finally relax. I bet it would feel better if I just laid my head over on this pillow, just a little bit. I'm still watching. Then my eyes start getting heavy, and I think, every time I blink, it takes me a little bit longer to raise my eyelids. I think, well, I'm just going to close my eyes. I can still listen to it. I'm still hearing it. And you know, what's the next thing that's happening? I'm waking up to the loud music at the end with the credits rolling, and there, I've done it again. I've taken my evening nap before I go to bed. And so my intentions are good, but let's face it, especially this time of year, we're all running around on fumes. We've got so much that needs to be done, and we are tired. Our bodies need rest. We hear the word Christmas, and automatically, it's like our to-do list just blossoms. We're programmed to feel like this is such a special, holly jolly time of the year. In fact, it's the most wonderful time on the year. And on the one hand, I want us to come to church and be surrounded by the beauty of our sanctuary this time of year. And maybe if you've worshiped with us for quite some time, you kind of have that feeling of nostalgia. You can remember, like maybe when these chrismons were made, or who made the ceramic trees or nativity sets or something like that. And so when you come in this door, I want you to be transported for a while, almost into a different realm. And I want you to have this sacred space that is a different reality than the rest of the week. And so therefore, as Christians, we come together and we light candles. And we have purple, which, you know, is kind of a strange color, you know, considered by the rest of our culture. We put up chrismons and we sing these old familiar carols. And if nostalgia is what it takes for you to get to that sweet emotional place, then I'm okay with that. So imagine how thrilled I was when I started planning for Advent, and I pop open my Bible, and I see that the first gospel reading is from Mark chapter 13. We're closer to the end of Jesus' life than his beginning. Also, people coming to church on the Sunday of Hope, they have to hear this really dramatic, apocalyptic message. Yuck! What's going on here? The scripture reminds us that as Jesus came into the world, the people needed hope. They had been praying for a Messiah who would lead them back to the heart of God. But as Mark is writing his gospel, the people are contemplating life after the destruction of the temple. They had endured years of an extended period of war and persecution by the Romans. What we just heard was written after a period of calamity and destruction. And the community is writing this testament to help them make sense of what has happened to them. It is written in a way that gives them a future hope. The way they interpret hope is for this old order to pass away, and Jesus, the one that we are welcoming into the world, is going to usher in a new one. In this way, for us, he is at once Jesus, that Jew from Nazareth, as well as this great Christ and cosmic King. He is the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. We were reminded last Sunday that purple is the color for getting ready. It's the liturgical color that tells us as the church it's time to prepare. The first Sunday of Advent orients us to what we should prepare. For Christmas? Maybe. But it's so much more than that. It's not just about Jesus' first coming, but his second. Therefore, Advent has tones of eschatology. When we contemplate endings, even those endings that can be new beginnings. For Mark's community, they sought an end to war and persecution. And I would love to say that so much has changed after 2,000 years, but you know I'd be lying. There is still war raging between Ukraine and Russia. There has been terroristic activity between Hamas and Israel. There are still places in this world where persecution and oppression exist. We want these things to end, and we look to Jesus, who is our hope, to end those things. I want us to notice that Mark's community does not wait passively, nor do they hope as if it is some kind of a wish. They are bidden time and time again throughout that scripture to remain alert. For any of you who are nodding off, I yell this again, wake up, pay attention. There's nothing quite as exhausting as someone telling you to stay awake, especially if you have to wait, especially if what you think is going to be a short waiting period becomes extended and more extended. We all know how that feels, whether we're waiting in traffic or we're in the waiting room of our doctor's office for that appointment that we had that was supposed to start 35 minutes ago, or whether this time of year we're standing in line at the post office. We must wait. And the timing is not up to us. That's the most frustrating part of it all. And so these examples that I've listed, I mean, they're relatively small matters compared to waiting for war to end, for oppression to cease, for all the world as we know it to be replaced completely by the kingdom of God, where such odd things will happen, like lions lying down with lambs. And I realize that much of the church year, I'm telling you, rest. Observe Sabbath. Take time. Tend your bodies, your spirits, and your minds. And I hope that I don't stop telling you that anytime soon. We need that. And we need that in Advent as much or more than we need it any other time of year. And we must be watchful and alert for the things that matter. That's the caveat. For the things that matter. For the small ways that we can help bring God to bear on someone else's life. We must be alert, not just for the child in the manger, but the children in our midst. We are alert for ways that the kingdom can be made visible right here, right now, right in front of us. And as we do these things that matter, we also wait for the things that only God can do in the ways that we cannot possibly understand. And so we wait. It's frustrating, but we wait. We wait with those who have a new cancer diagnosis. We wait with those in hospital rooms as medical experts and machines keep a loved one's body alive. We wait, and we are alert to all the realities, and we are aware, just like the Israelites long ago who waited for their Messiah, and the community of Jews and Christians, Mark's community, who might have lost hope when they saw Jesus preparing to die on a cross. We are alert to the present reality. But we also know that what we see does not reveal all of who God is. And we wait, but not as others do. We wait as people who have hope. I want you this holiday season to be present to the hope that is in our midst and be that hope to other people. Thanks be to God. We are all invited to this table of our Lord Jesus. This is one of the ways that we acknowledge the continual gift of his presence with us. We remember each and every week the rituals of his Last Supper with his disciples, which he offered this invitation for them, and it echoes true for us, that as long as we are together at meals, as long as we break bread and lift up cups, we know that we are never alone. We are never far from his presence. And this is the invitation now, the gift of his presence with each other and with God. This is the mystical union that binds us to Christ. So please draw closer, be present in this moment to all who have ever gathered at this table, no matter where and no matter when. We prepare our hearts and minds to receive this meal by singing our communion hymn number 124. This is an old chant of the early church that is still with us here in our chalice meal. Let all mortal flesh keep silence.
Let all mortal flesh keep silence, and with fear and trembling stand. Ponder nothing earthly minded, for with blessing in his hand, Christ our God to earth descended, our full homage to demand. Truly God yet born,
most heavenly and gracious Father, As we come to the sacred table, we give thanks for the invitation to share in this symbolic feast. Prepare our hearts for communion with you by drawing near and revealing your presence. As we share this cup and loaf, we are reminded of Christ's broken body and spilled blood upon Calvary's cruel cross. We know as believers that Christ's ultimate sacrifice made possible the forgiveness of our many transgressions. And finally, give us the opportunity and the will to become more Christ-like in our daily lives. These things we ask in your Son's name. Same way he took the cup, also after supper, saying,
This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.
So as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Once again, I greet you warmly in the name of Christ our Lord on this first Sunday of Advent. If you have not already had a chance to do so, please fill out the welcome card that is in your bulletin. And of course, fill out the front matter, especially if you need to change your contact information with the church office. But especially important is on the back, where we ask you to list your gratitude. For this next act of worship, our offering is really an opportunity for us to say thank you to God for the gifts that God has already blessed us with. So please write that down. These are shared in our church's newsletter. And also, share with us any ministry hours that you've done in the community so that we can continue to count that very important metric and report it to the church. Every good gift is from God. During this season of gifts and giving, let us remember the one who has given us all.
Let us pray. Holy and gracious God,
to your people. May we, at this time of year, be reminded to be like you in our generous spirits, to give to those who are less fortunate, so that they might know your goodness through us. We pray all this in your Son's holy name. Amen. And now your invitation to discipleship. All who call upon the name of the Lord, we ask you to increase in faith each and every Sunday, so that by being here and being in the community, by hearing God's word proclaimed through scripture, sermon, and song, that something in us is changed and God is working to transform us into the likeness of Christ. We sing now our hymn of departing, which is number 233. Alleluia, sing to Jesus.
Alleluia, sing to Jesus, risen now to reign in love. Alleluia, praise the Savior with the multitudes above. There the songs of saints and martyrs thunder like a mighty flood. Jesus out of every nation has redeemed us by his blood. Alleluia, not as orphans we are left in sorrow now. Alleluia, Christ is near us, faith believes nor questions how. Though the cloud from sight received him, when the 40 days were o'er, shall our hearts forget the promise, I am with you evermore. Alleluia, bread of heaven, be on earth our food and stay. Alleluia, hear the sinful flee to you from day to day. Intercessor, friend of sinners, earth's redeemer, plead for me. Where the songs of all the sinless sweep across the crystal sea.
Well, hallelujah, we've made it through the first Sunday of Advent. Not worse for wear. It makes us appreciate ever more fully our director of music, Doug Price. So we'll continue to pray for his improved health. We're not quite with the non-instrumental Church of Christ in terms of our congregational seat, but I'm really, really pleased. So now I want to remind you to sign cards, to sign up for the retreat next weekend. It'll be Saturday, the 9th. We'll start gathering before 10 and truly start at 10 a.m. And don't forget the bylaw revision committee after church.
Also, if you haven't thought about it yet, there are cards you can fill out to purchase poinsettias to finish the decorating of our church for Christmas Eve service. You have today and next Sunday this week in which to complete that task.
Excellent. Thank you.
And everybody come Thursday to hear the children and have a little bite of dessert afterwards.
Thank you, Sally. All right. Let's receive this benediction. The good news of Jesus Christ is that God is with us. No matter what, no matter where, no matter when, there is no place you can go where God is not. No time of the day when God is off the clock. This is the teaching of the Incarnation, God with us, Emmanuel. So now go and be truly present so you may be a gift of presence for others. That's all that is expected of you, that the gift that is given is you. So go forth from this place and be the best gift you can be in the name of the Holy Presence, the divine gift, and the spirit of hope that is just waiting for us to unwrap abundant life. Amen.
Amen. Amen.